Hey everybody, Norm over here at Norm's Rare Guitars. I got the great Grant Geissman and the great Frank Stallone over here. And we're having a little session talking about some stuff. And these guys were playing together a little bit. It sounds fantastic. And I was talking to Grant, and I told Frank that Grant played, you know, with Chuck Mangione for many years. And then Frank told this story, and we got to unleash Frank a little bit.
Grant corroborated with me. It was true.
All right, so let's hear it.
Well, I was playing the 20th anniversary of Hair at the United Nations, and Chuck was there, and Joe Beam was there, and, you know, Bea Arthur was there. I don't know what the hell she was singing, but she was there. And so after we went
she
to
she was a, in your band.
She was in my band. Yeah. She played pedal steel.
Maud. Maud and Frank.
So, and Treat Williams. And so it was a big celebration of the 20th anniversary of Hair, okay. So after that, went to a club called Regine's. And legend is, it always was, that was John Gotti, who at that time was head of the Gambino family's hangout. He used to go there like every night. So I'm sitting there like, you know, kind of, you know, doing my thing. And a guy walks up and he goes, hey, you want to meet the boss? And I said, I didn't know Springsteen was here. He goes, no, what are you talking about? So I walk over and it's John Gotti. And he's sitting there with these guys around him. You know, you can't miss him with the white hair and stuff like that. So, you know, I'm just sitting there gabbing and gabbing. Now Chuck, I'll take it there and then Grant can take it. So Chuck Mangione's there. And he is like three sheets to the wind. I mean, he's blasted.
And occasionally Chuck would get overserved.
Yes, overserved, yes. Yeah, he was overserved that night.
Yeah.
And so he's walking around with this flugelhorn in Regine's.
He used to do that. He would be at a dinner or whatever, and he'd get his horn out and walk around and play for people. And he'd play Feel So Good or whatever. Or if it was someone's birthday, he'd play Happy Birthday, whatever. Yeah. But he would do this thing.
And it was harmless. Yeah. But anyway, he was getting in John Gotti's space. Hey, how you doing? And dancing around with this hat on, with the hair, and John Gotti like this. So he's kind of like, and I see these guys sitting around. These guys, I mean, Chuck is maybe 5'1", and these guys are sitting around like as big as this couch. Hey, John, you want us to take care of this? He goes, nah, leave alone, and tell him what he said then.
Well, I wasn't there, but Chuck tells this story, and so, you know, Chuck makes the rounds, he leaves the thing and makes the rounds, and somebody goes, Chuck, you know who that guy was? The guy who were in his face? And it's like, no, it was John Gotti. And Chuck's like, oh, no, you know.
Not
and
petrified.
Then one of Gotti's guys comes over, one of his goons, and he goes, hey, John wants your hat. And Chuck's like,
yeah,
you got it. Here
he
you
reconsidered,
go.
And there was a reason why Chuck wore that hat. He didn't have that much up top. I think
right.
He lost his ego at that point when the head of the Gambino family says he wants your hat. And but I remember that, and they kind of handed it back to him. It was just like, yeah, just goofing with him. But it was kind of funny. He just had no idea until he was told who it was. And then
he was freaking out.
Freaking out, but he's very sweet.
Did you give John Gotti your hat?
I didn't have a hat, but if I had a hairpiece, I would have taken off. Hey, you can have it. I would have done a Carl Reiner. I said, hey, pal, you can have it. But, you know, so I sat with John Gotti, and he was, I mean, he definitely had charisma. I mean, you knew it was him. The silver hair and the suits and surrounded by about six really
goons,
yeah, real Italian.
Now, one thing I want to say is that, you know, the management of this store, which is me or the ownership, takes no responsibility for Frank Stallone. But Frank has done a few videos over here, and you know, he gets some comments on the videos, and you know, tell us what you really think, Frank.
Well, I'll tell you what's happening. You know, I bought a few guitars here, Grant. I bought one today. So I bought a few guitars here over the time. And, you know, so we sit there, and Norm and I have known each other 30 plus years or more. And so we sit there and talk, but I'm not sitting there going, so anyway, dude. So people are going, oh, well, can you play that? Some of the comments, well, can you play that thing? You're sitting there. Or it's like, do you need any more guitars? Yeah. I mean,
yeah.
Do you need any more women?
You just need just one more.
One more. So I said, if you want to see guys showing off, just go to Guitar Center. You'll see some guy from like Inland Empire sitting there playing notes that no one cares about, you know, just nonsensical stuff on like a Kramer or a Shark or something like that. I said, but most guys, like, we get to a point in our life, we're just sitting there kind of doodling and really savoring these beautiful guitars. I mean, what are you gonna do? What are you gonna play? Like Smoke on the Water on a Super 400? You know what I mean? So it's like, so we're just sitting there.
So, Frank, what do you really think about these guys making these comments? I mean, you know.
Well, I mean, some of them are, I got to say, the majority of them are really wonderful.
Yeah.
And they, you know, and they love the idea, like my brother got me this, my brother got me a 1940 Epiphone Emperor for Christmas. And it was really unexpected here.
Nice.
And it belonged to the Sons of the Pioneers.
And his words, what did he say?
Oh, I saw that. And it had a case,
your
like
brother,
an engraved
when he,
case.
When he got the guitar.
I forget, what did he say?
Well, I don't remember the words, but
he
in his
said,
voice.
You know. Well, what happened, he called me, and I was in the store already. And Norm says, you know, Norm, go, you know, Frank, I don't want to tell you this, but there's someone that wants to buy you a guitar. And I can't think of who would want to buy me a guitar, because a gal bought me a guitar 2 years ago for my birthday, a Gretsch White Falcon, which is beautiful. So I can't think of anybody. And
I don't know anybody who likes you that
no,
much.
No, likes me that much. I mean, I say, was it Richie Sambora? You know, whatever. But anyway, so all of a sudden, I'm walking around the store, and I'm figuring, who the hell would buy me a guitar? So Norm's like, hey, look around. See what you see. So now I'm getting all confused.
And he's like, got me mixed up with his brother.
And then I get a call. Then I get a call, and the guy, it's my brother. Yeah, how you doing? I said, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm in the valley. The valley? What are you doing in the valley? You know, I said, well, you know, I'm at my friend's guitar store. And all of a sudden, I hear, like, silence. He goes, what? Where are you? I said, I'm in Norman's guitar, my friend Norm. He goes, oh, that's nice. And all of a sudden, I see him. He knows nothing about guitars. So he tells me, he's, like, reading off a card. So what do you think of J200? I said, oh, they're great. I got two of them. Oh, yeah? So what do you think of that Les Paul? Yeah, I said, I love them. I have a lot of them. They're great. He goes, yeah, yeah. Would you like one? I go, well, I have a few. He goes, well, look around. See, so now I'm having a meltdown. Now I'm in Norman's Rare Guitars, the greatest vintage guitar store in the world.
And excuse me, could you repeat that one time?
I'm in Norman's Rare Guitars, actually the greatest vintage guitar store in the world.
Just in case he stutters a little.
Yeah. And now I'm confused because I'm looking at that Gibson harp guitar. I'm looking at that three-point mandolin. I'm looking at stuff, and I can't make a decision. And so I said to you, I said, Grant, man, take any guitar you want.
I'd have to go to the warehouse.
Yeah, that's the place. Or you might walk off with this one. So, and that's what
not
happened.
Not bad right now.
That's not too bad. That's pretty serious. And so... And then he told Norm, what did he say about a drink or something?
Oh, I said, you know, I've known your brother for years, and you know, we're good friends, and he's bought a lot of guitars for me. And then his brother said, do you want me to buy you a bottle of bourbon or something? You know,
yeah, he goes, yeah, I should buy you a bottle of bourbon because he's putting up with me for 35 years. But actually, and so, but I get some comments. Most of them are nice. Some of them you can tell as a guy, like you need another guitar. I said, actually, yes, I do. I mean, it's like if you were like at a, you know, a Ford modeling show, do you need another model? Yeah, if it's there, sure. Yeah. So, and that's, but I think a lot of people don't understand. It's kind of addiction.
Yeah, but it's a good addiction.
It's a good addiction. I mean, you're not getting drugs.
Especially
you're not hurting
for me.
Anyway. And I work for it. You know, my brother gave me that beautiful guitar, which I'll cherish. I mean, I play them. Don't you play yours?
I do.
Yeah, sometimes you go through moods. You go, okay, now I'm into the L5. I'll play that. And then you go, I'll try the Strat or this.
Yeah.
And so you just mix around. But you get a lot of guys. But I said, if you want flash guitar, go to Guitar Center or Sam Ash. You'll find a lot of kids that have no sense of musicality at all.
No sense of decency.
No, decency. Play Lydian modes and the way they can't even play that. I mean, just like.
Well, if they were paid by the note, then it would make a lot of sense.
Well, that's what happened at Harvell's. I was playing, it was blues night, and I was sitting there, and this old black dude came walking in wearing a maintenance man outfit, you know, with an old 335, but it had like regular screws in it instead of like, you know, proper Gibson things. And he was sitting there, he said, my name is like Memphis Red or something. You know, everyone makes up a name. So all these guys are up there playing. So he gets on stage, right? And he's kind of a real guy. And he's sitting there talking to the girls. Yeah, now everybody, I want to tell you, grab a hand, girl. You know, he's getting all that club shit. This guy probably played a million clubs. And all of a sudden he goes, all right, take it, son. So his kid had like the Flock of Seagulls hairdo playing like a BC Rich, which is a real blues guitar, like the Shark. And he's there like this, take it, son, with the Floyd Rose. And he went like this, what are you getting paid, about a motherfucking note? Yeah. Well, B.B. King said, I get paid for the notes I don't play.
That's right. I like that.
It's really not how many you play. Like our friend Little Beaver in Florida, I consider him a really great guitar player, but very sparse.
Well, Grant can play a lot of notes, but he plays all the right notes. That's the thing.
Well, there is
no wrong note. It's just there's wrong notes for certain tunes.
Wrong note is it's like the wrong note at the wrong place.
Yeah. That's it.
But I mean, B.B. King, would you say, probably the most imitated blues guitar player in history.
The thing that's great about B.B. is you can hear him play one or two notes and you immediately know who
it
is.
Him.
There's very few guitar players that's the case.
No. And
you
the thing
just
is...
go,
And they said,
"BB, that's BB.
BB, that's a chord." He goes, "I don't play chords."
Yeah,
he doesn't play chords. He just, you know, like you said, and he's just an amazing guy. Now, getting to these guitars. Now, this is a real old Super 400. This is the grandfather to that Super 400, and this has a pretty good price tag. That's got a serious price tag. That's $24,000. But
$24,000. I can't touch this.
Forget it. But this is a real PAF Florentine cutaway blonde 63. This is a serious guitar. You know.
Absolutely.
So we will show you how this guitar should be
played. How about you guys playing a little bit,
so that. Okay. We'll just kind of do some of the old swing. That's what these guitars were for. This was not a shredding guitar, right? So we'll try some. One, two. One, two, three, four.
Geissman. So I always enjoy having these guys hear the music. Frank actually really plays that chord stuff really well, that swinging
good
chord
time.
Stuff.
This guy's got good time.
And he's got a great voice. I don't want it to let it go to his head now because
they let
him out on the weekends.
They
usually comes in with a nurse.
But that's how they play these things. I mean, people don't understand. They're little trebly like these, but if you're the big band, you're
through.
Going,
no ass. No abs in those days.
And that's how it was. So they actually really probably had very heavy black diamond strings at that point.
Yeah, they would hit hard too.
Hit really hard.
They would cut through the big band.
That's it. Now, I'm sure a lot of your viewers have never seen that chord before. So I know it's not an A major, so. But this is how these things are played, and it's wonderful meeting Grant, and it's amazing. So now you know when I tell you something, it's the truth, and that's over 30 years ago, and I still remember that. I mean, it'd be like if you went up to Lucky Luciano. Hey, you want to play my flugelhorn? Yeah, I mean, it's just like, you know, thank God, Mr. Gotti.
He's lucky he asked for his hat and not his head.
Yeah, exactly.
How about the guy said, hey, you know what?
He could have asked him for the horn. I mean,
yeah,
I want
I'm
the
sure
horn. I'm
going to
go hang it on the wall.
It goes like this.
If I don't get the horn, I'm going to hang your head on my wall.
Bring me the hat with his head with it.
Yeah.
Then stick it in the horn.
Yeah.
So they used Chuck Mangione's head for a mute for his flugelhorn. You know what I mean? But this is a long one. This is Frank Stallone Unleashed. But again, this is a place where really
this is a place where the magic happens.
The magic happens.
And if you made it all the way to the end of this video, Norm's got a free guitar pick for you.
There you go. It's that bad one that was cracked. But no, we want to take care of you guys. So Frank is great to buy guitars for everybody who watches.
Yes, right on.
And I want to thank all the fans that say nice things about me on all these videos. And I must tell you, these videos are very effective. I went to the NAMM show, and I can't tell you how many people stopped me. Hey, Frank Stallone, can I have a picture? Can I have a selfie? Hey, yeah, saw you on Norm's, man, love it. You know, so I mean, it does, the internet really reaches out. I mean, it really reaches out to a lot of people. I mean, millions of people. How many hits did we have on that one?
People watch this on the interweb? This is unbelievable.
A million hits on this one I did with my brother. A million.
You know what's actually, you know, I just got to tell you, I've been to a couple of Frank's shows, and Frank is very entertaining, plays all kinds of music, sings real well, but what kills me is when he starts talking to the audience, goes into his brother's voice and all that kind of stuff. It's like, you know, it's extremely entertaining. So if Frank Stallone is playing in your neighborhood, you got to go see him. And if you can bring John Gotti along with you, that probably will get you a good
ashes.
Seat.
John Gotti urn. You know, but
let's be respectful.
Well, no. Yeah.
You know, I'm not saying anything bad, John. I love you.
Hey, listen.
You are a great-looking guy.
I got to tell you something really funny about John Gotti. And he was always nice to me, so I have nothing bad to say about him. You know,
me either.
Me neither. I'm doing Howard Stern's show, and this was when Mr. Gotti was going through all the stuff with the trials and stuff like this. So I'm on there with David Brenner. And Howard's just going, oh, yeah, what do you think about John Gotti? He's starting to, like, say, I said, and he goes,
set you up.
Well, yeah, trying to set me up to say something. I'm in New York. You then would say something, which I wouldn't anyway, about John Gotti. And all of a sudden, David Brenner, they asked, so what do you guys think? Dave's going, oh, we're good, man. John Gotti? Great, man. I'm like, oh, John Gotti's a gentleman. He's wonderful. I said, Howard, at the end, I said, are you trying to get us killed? Are you crazy? We would have never made it out of the studio. They've had a guy put three in our ear. You know what I mean? David Brenner was going, he goes, Howard, are you out of your mind? This is the head of the Gambino family, and you want us to sit there and crack wise, which I wouldn't have done anyway, because it's, you know, it's not my thing. But there's certain things you joke about, and there's certain things you don't.
Well, just because I'm not joking, my love to the Gotti family.
Me too.
And the entire Gambino clan.
Buona notte. Yeah, grazie. Until then, ci vediamo, Lord, mi chiamo Francesco Stallone. Hey, arrivederci. Thank you.
Frank Stallone, the great Grant Geissman. And me apologizing for anything Frank might have said.
That's right.
I'm completely, love everybody. Yes. I love everybody.
Thank you.
Norm's Rare Guitar is right here.
That's a good one.